नेफ्रोटिक सिंड्रोम। नेफ्रोटिक सिंड्रोम इज द क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ ग्लोमेरुलर डिजीजेस एसोसिएटेड विद हेवी प्रोटीनोरिया। नेफ्रोटिक रेंज प्रोटीनोरिया इज डिफाइंड एज मोर देन 3.5 ग्राम पर 24 आवर और ए यूरिन प्रोटीन क्रिएटिनिन रेशियो मोर देन 2। The primary function of the kidneys are to excrete the toxic metabolites from the body, and their function is best measured as the glomerular filtration rate. As the blood passes through the glomerular capillaries, the plasma is filtered through the glomerular capillary walls. Small plasma molecules such as electrolytes, glucose, phosphates, urea, creatinine, peptides, low molecular weight proteins filter freely, whereas larger molecules such as albumin, globulin are retained in the circulation. The charge and size selective properties of the glomerular capillary wall prevents significant amounts of albumin, globulin and other large plasma proteins from entering the urinary space. Smaller proteins of size 15 to 40 kilodaltons do cross the capillary walls but are reabsorbed by the proximal tubule. A very small amount of protein that normally appears in the urine is the result of normal tubular secretion and consists of TAM Hirschwall protein, also called as uromodulin, a protective glycoprotein secreted by the tubules that inactivates cytokines. As you can see in the diagram, the three-layered glomerular filtration barrier consists of the fenestrated endothelium, podocyte foot processes with bridging slit diaphragms, and the intervening glomerular basement membrane. The negative charge associated with each of the three layers is thought to retard filtration of the anionic molecules such as albumin, facilitate the filtration of cationic molecules, and have little impact on the neutral molecules. Abnormal amounts of protein may appear in the urine from three possible mechanisms. Number one, the glomerular proteinuria, which occurs as a result of disruption of the glomerular capillary wall. Tubular proteinuria, ineffective reabsorption of mostly low molecular weight proteins from tubules as a result of injury or dysfunction. And third mechanism is due to increased production of plasma proteins as seen in multiple myeloma, rhabdomyolysis or hemolysis, which may cause the production or release of very large amounts of protein that are filtered at the glomerulus and overwhelm the absorptive capacity of the proximal tubule. About 5 to 15% of children and adolescents, the finding of proteinuria in a single non-first morning urine sample is very common, and the prevalence of the persistent proteinuria on repeated testing is much less common. Therefore, the challenge is to differentiate the child with proteinuria related to renal disease from the otherwise healthy child with transient or other benign forms of proteinuria. When proteinuria is detected, it is important to determine if it is transient, orthostatic, or fixed in nature. As already mentioned, approximately 10% of children who undergo random urine analysis have proteinuria by a single dipstick measurement. Serial testing of the patient's urine demonstrates resolution of the abnormality. This phenomena defines transient proteinuria, and the defined contributing factors include fever, exercise, dehydration, exposure to cold, heart failure, use of epinephrine, seizures, and stress. And this finding is more common in adolescents than in younger children. Orthostatic proteinuria is the most common cause of persistent proteinuria in school-age children and adolescents, occurring in up to 60% of children with persistent proteinuria. And patient with orthostatic proteinuria excrete normal or minimally increased amounts of protein in the supine position. But in the upright position, urinary protein excretion may be increased tenfold up to 1 gram per 24 hours. Abnormal findings such as hematuria, hypertension, hypoalbuminemia, edema, and renal dysfunction are absent. The exact cause of orthostatic proteinuria is unknown, although altered renal hemodynamics and partial left renal vein obstruction in the upright lordotic position have been proposed as possible causes. Patient and family should be reassured of the benign nature of this condition. Any children with proteinuria of more than or equal to 1 plus protein on dipstick testing with a urine specific gravity of more than 1.015 or with a urine protein to creatinine ratio of more than or equal to 0.2 on a first morning urine sample on 3 separate occasions should be investigated further and is called as fixed proteinuria. And it indicates a potential kidney disease caused by either glomerular or tubular disorders. The causes of fixed proteinuria is as follows. Glomerular diseases characterized by isolated proteinuria include minimal stains disease, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, mesangial proliferative glomerulonephritis, membranous nephropathy, membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, amyloidosis, diabetic nephropathy, sickle cell nephropathy. And the glomerular diseases with proteinuria as a prominent feature include acute post-infectious glomerulonephritis, immunoglobulin A nephropathy, HSP nephritis, lupus nephritis, serum sickness, Alport syndrome, vasculitic disorders, and reflux nephropathy. Tubular diseases associated with fixed proteinuria are cystinosis, Fanconi syndrome, Wilson disease, Lowy syndrome, Dent disease, galactosemia, tubular interstitial nephritis, acute tubular necrosis, renal dysplasia, polycystic kidney disease, reflux nephropathy, renal transplant rejection, drugs, and heavy metals. The commonly used tests to detect protein in the urine are dipstick testing, 24-hour urine for protein and creatinine excretion, spot urine protein creatinine ratio, preferably on the first morning urine sample. Among them, dipstick testing is the most easy and convenient method and is reported as negative trace 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus based on the quantity of protein present in the urine. Sometimes it gives false positive results if urine is very alkaline, has pH more than 8, or very concentrated, specific gravity of more than 1.025. This diagram shows how urine dipstick test is carried out. Dipstick is completely immersed in the urine sample, and the color changes are compared with the standard chart and quantified accordingly. Now coming back to the nephrotic syndrome, as already defined, it is the clinical manifestation of glomerular diseases associated with heavy proteinuria, that is more than 3.5 gram in 24 hours, or a urine protein creatinine ratio of more than 2. The clinical triad associated with nephrotic syndrome arising from the large urinary losses of protein are hypoalbuminemia, edema, and hyperlipidemia. Causes of nephrotic syndrome. Idiopathic nephrotic syndrome means the exact cause is not clearly defined and the pathological types are minimal change disease, FSGS, membranous nephropathy, and glomerulonephritis associated with nephrotic syndrome. The second group is genetic disorders associated with nephrotic syndrome. Absence of nephrin causes Finnish type of congenital nephrotic syndrome, and mutation in nephrin podocin alpha actin 4 and TRPC6 causes FSGS type of nephrotic syndrome, and mutation in laminin beta 2 chain causes diffuse mesangial sclerosis, and mutation in WT1 transcription factor causes Dennis-Drasch syndrome. Integrin alpha 3 mutation causes congenital nephrotic syndrome with lung and skin involvement, and other genetic disorders associated with nephrotic syndrome or nephrotic range of proteinuria include Nile Patella syndrome, Alport syndrome, Galloway-Mowat syndrome, Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease, Jeune syndrome, Cocaine syndrome, Lorenz-Mounbeil-Bardet syndrome. Some metabolic disorders associated with nephrotic syndrome include Alagille syndrome, alpha-1-antitrypsin deficiency, Fabry disease, glutaric acidemia, glycogen storage disease, Hurler syndrome, partial lipodystrophy, mitochondrial cytopathies, sickle cell disease. Secondary causes of nephrotic syndrome include infections such as hepatitis B, C, cytomegalovirus, malaria, etc., and drugs such as captopril, penicillamine gold, pamidronate, interferon, mercury, etc. Immunological or allergic disorders such as vasculitic syndrome, Castleman disease, Kimura disease, etc. Malignant diseases such as Wilms tumor, lymphoma, pheochromocytoma, leukemia, thymoma, and solid tumors. Glomerular hyperfiltration secondary to morbid obesity, oligomeganephronia, or adaptation to nephron reduction. Coming to pathogenesis of nephrotic syndrome, podocyte is a highly differentiated epithelial cell located on the outside of the glomerular capillary loop. Foot processes are extension of the podocyte that terminate on the glomerular basement membrane. These foot processes interdigitate with those from adjacent podocyte and are connected by a slit called slit diaphragm made of proteins such as nephrin, podocin, CD2AP and alpha actinin 4. Any type of injury to these podocytes or genetic mutations of genes producing podocyte proteins may cause nephrotic range of proteinuria. In this diagram, we can see the normal podocyte with arrangement of foot processes and formation of slit diaphragm. As you can see in the diagram, the presence of a normal glomerular basement membrane with healthy podocyte foot processes, serum protein, mainly albumin, remain within the glomerular capillary lumen. But the mechanisms that are as yet not fully elucidated but are partly intrinsic to the podocyte and partly due to the presence of soluble mediators released by a dysregulated immune system modify this integrity. Therefore, the actin cytoskeleton of the podocyte and the glomerular basement membrane are disrupted, and albumin and other serum proteins filter out of the bloodstream and into the urinary space. In idiopathic, hereditary, and secondary forms of nephrotic syndrome, there are immune and non-immune insults to the podocytes that lead to foot process effacement of the podocyte, a decrease in number of functional podocytes, and altered slit diaphragm integrity. The end result is increased protein leakiness across the glomerular capillary wall into the urinary space. Minimal change nephrotic syndrome may occur after viral infection and allergic changes, and in children with Hodgkin lymphoma and T-cell lymphoma. Therefore, immunosuppression with drugs such as corticosteroids, cyclosporins provides indirect additional evidence that the immune system contributes to the overall pathogenesis of the nephrotic syndrome. Clinical consequences of nephrotic syndrome. Edema is the most common presenting symptom of children with nephrotic syndrome, and mechanism of edema formation is explained by two hypotheses. The underfill hypothesis. Nephrotic range proteinuria that leads to a fall in the plasma protein level with a corresponding decrease in the vascular oncotic pressure. This leads to leakage of plasma water into the interstitium and generating edema. Sodium and water retention therefore occurs as a consequence of intravascular volume depletion. And the overfill hypothesis postulates that nephrotic syndrome is associated with primary sodium retention with subsequent volume expansion and leakage of excess fluid in the interstitium. This flow diagram clearly explains the pathophysiology of edema formation. In case of idiopathic nephrotic syndrome, there will be hypoalbuminemia as a result of marked proteinuria, which causes low capillary colloidal oncotic pressure, which decreases the effective circulatory volume. Therefore, there will be secondary or compensatory renal sodium and water reabsorption causes edema, and this hypothesis is called underfill hypothesis. There are several alterations in the lipid profile in children with nephrotic syndrome, including increase in cholesterol, triglycerides, low density lipoproteins, and very low density lipoproteins. The high density lipoproteins remains unchanged or is low. In adults, this results in an increase in the adverse cardiovascular risk ratio, although the implications for children are not as serious. Hyperlipidemia is thought to be the result of increased synthesis as well as decreased catabolism of lipids. As you can see in the diagram, the ability of the liver to capture circulating low density lipoprotein is reduced because of low expression of the LDL receptor due to its loss in the urine. This implies a low concentration of intrahepatic free cholesterol that determines the activation of compensatory pathway. An increased activity of HMG-CoA reductase and ACAT lead to an increased endogenous synthesis of cholesterol, while a reduced activity of the enzyme 7-hydroxylase results in lower use of cholesterol in the bile synthesis. The final result is an increased hepatic production of cholesterol that is poured into the circulation, causing hypercholesterolemia. The children with nephrotic syndrome are especially susceptible to infections such as cellulitis, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, and bacteremia. This occurs as a result of urine loss of immunoglobulin G and complementary factors. Therefore, these children are at significantly increased risk for infection with encapsulated bacteria such as pneumococci and H. influenza. Any children with nephrotic syndrome and fever or other signs of infection must be evaluated aggressively with appropriate cultures drawn and should be treated promptly and empirically with antibiotics. Nephrotic syndrome is a hypercoagulable state resulting from multiple factors including vascular stasis from hemoconcentration and intravascular volume depletion, increased platelet number and aggregability, and changes in coagulation factor levels. And also there is an increase in hepatic production of fibrinogen along with urine losses of antithrombin factors such as antithrombin 3 and proteinase. Deep vein thrombosis may occur as a result of hypercoagulable state in any venous blood, including the cerebral venous sinus, renal veins, and pulmonary veins. Although the clinical risk is low in children compared with adult, but it has the potential for serious consequences. With understanding the basics of proteinuria and nephrotic syndrome in general, Now coming to the most common type of nephrotic syndrome that we come across in pediatric age group, that is idiopathic nephrotic syndrome. Idiopathic nephrotic syndrome is a primary glomerular disease without an identifiable causative disease or drug. Approximately 90% of children with nephrotic syndrome have idiopathic nephrotic syndrome. Based on the pathological changes, is classified into minimal change disease, mesangial proliferative nephrotic syndrome, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, membranous nephropathy, and membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis. Minimal change nephrotic syndrome make up 85% of the total cases of nephrotic syndrome in children. On light microscopic examination, the glomeruli appear normal or show a minimal increase in mesangial cells and matrix. Findings on immunofluorescence microscopy are typically negative. Electron microscopy reveals effacement of the epithelial cell foot processes. Mesangial proliferative nephrotic syndrome is characterized by diffuse increase in mesangial cells and matrix on light microscopy. Immunofluorescence microscopy might reveal traces to 1 plus mesangial IgM or IgA staining. Electron microscopy reveals increased numbers of mesangial cells and matrix as well as effacement of the epithelial cell foot processes. Approximately 50% of patients with this histological lesion respond to corticosteroid therapy. In focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, glomeruli show lesions that are both local and segmental, and the lesions consist of mesangial cell proliferation and segmental scarring on light microscopy. Immunofluorescence microscopy is positive for IgM and C3 staining in the areas of segmental sclerosis. Electron microscopy demonstrates segmental scarring of the glomerular tuft with obliteration of the glomerular capillary lumen. FSGS changes may be seen secondary to HIV infection, vesicoureteral reflux, and intravenous use of heroin and other drugs of abuse. Only 20% of patients with FSGS respond to prednisolone. The disease is often progressive, ultimately involving all glomeruli with end-stage renal disease in most patients. Idiopathic nephrotic syndrome is more common in males with a ratio of 2:1 and is most commonly appears between the age of 2 and 6 years. However, it has been reported as early as 6 months of age and throughout adulthood. Minimal change nephrotic syndrome is present in 85% to 90% of patients less than 6 years of age. In contrast, only 20% to 30% of adolescents who present for the first time with nephrotic syndrome have minimal change nephrotic syndrome. FSGS is more common in older age groups and is the most common cause of end-stage renal disease in adolescents. Children with nephrotic syndrome usually present with mild edema, which is initially noted around the eyes and in the lower extremities. Sometimes it can be misdiagnosed as an allergic disorder because of the periorbital swelling that decreases throughout the day. With the time, the edema becomes generalized with the development of ascites, pleural effusion, and genital edema. Anorexia, irritability, abdominal pain, and diarrhea are common. Important features of minimal change idiopathic nephrotic syndrome are the absence of hypertension and gross hematuria. Differential diagnosis of the child with marked edema includes protein losing enteropathy, hepatic failure, heart failure, acute or chronic glomerulonephritis, and protein malnutrition. Laboratory test findings favoring diagnosis of nephrotic syndrome include 3 plus or 4 plus proteinuria and spot urine protein creatinine ratio of more than 2 on urine analysis, electrolyte imbalance such as hyponatremia, normal to elevated serum creatinine level, hypoalbuminemia that is less than 2.5 gram per dl, elevated serum cholesterol and triglyceride levels. Secondary forms of nephrotic syndromes are evaluated by C3 complement level, anti-nuclear antibodies, anti-double stranded DNA antibodies, hepatitis B and C, and HIV serology. Treatment of idiopathic nephrotic syndrome. Corticosteroids are the mainstay of therapy. The treatment guidelines for corticosteroid use are adapted from and based on the 2012 Kidney Disease Improving Global Outcomes Clinical Practice Guidelines on Glomerulonephritis. Treatment of the first episode of nephrotic syndrome. Prednisolone should be started as a single daily dose 60 mg per meter square of body surface area per day or 2 mg per kg per day to a maximum of 60 mg daily for 4 to 6 weeks, which followed by alternate day prednisolone with a dose of 40 mg per meter square of body surface area or 1.5 mg per kg per day for a period ranging from 8 weeks to 5 months with tapering of the dose. When planning the duration of steroid therapy, the side effects of prolonged corticosteroid administration must be kept in mind. Approximately 80 to 90% of children respond to steroid therapy. Any nephrotic syndrome patient should be defined based on the response to the steroid therapy. Nephrotic syndrome patient with urine protein creatinine ratio of less than 0.2 or less than 1 plus protein on urine dipstick testing for 3 consecutive days is called remission, and attainment of remission within the 4 weeks of corticosteroid therapy is called response. Most children with minimal change disease respond to daily prednisolone therapy or attain remission quickly within the first 2 to 3 weeks of treatment. A nephrotic syndrome patient who already attained remission comes with urine protein creatinine ratio of more than 0.2 or 2 plus or higher on urine dipstick testing for 3 consecutive days is called relapse. 2 or more relapses within 6 months after the initial therapy or 4 relapses in a 1 year of period is called frequent relapse. A nephrotic syndrome patient with remission relapse during steroid tapering or within 2 weeks of discontinuation of steroid therapy are called steroid dependent nephrotic syndrome. A nephrotic syndrome patient started on steroids, inability to induce remission within 4 weeks of daily steroid therapy should be labeled as steroid resistant nephrotic syndrome. Management of nephrotic syndrome patient with edema is as follows. Children with ascites or severe generalized edema should be hospitalized immediately. In addition to sodium restriction, water or fluid restriction may be necessary if the child is hyponatremic. A swollen scrotum may be elevated with pillows to enhance fluid removal by gravity. Diuresis may be augmented by administration of loop diuretics orally or IV, although extreme caution should be exercised. When a patient has a severe generalized edema with evidence of intravascular volume depletion, intravenous administration of 25% albumin as a slow infusion followed by furosemide is sometimes necessary. Management of infections in nephrotic syndrome patients. Families of children with nephrotic syndrome should be counseled regarding the signs and symptoms of infection such as cellulitis, peritonitis, and bacteremia. If there is suspicion of infection, a blood culture should be drawn prior to starting empirical antibiotic therapy. In case of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, peritoneal fluid should be collected if there is sufficient fluid to perform a paracentesis and sent for cell count, gram stain and culture. A third generation cephalosporins like ceftriaxone or cefotaxime is a common antibiotic of choice. Dyslipidemia should be managed with a low fat diet. Dietary fat intake should be limited to less than 30% of calories with a saturated fat intake of less than 10% calories. Dietary cholesterol intake should be less than 300 mg per day. Children who present with the clinical signs of thromboembolism should be evaluated by appropriate imaging studies to confirm the presence of a clot. Studies to delineate a specific underlying hypercoagulable state are recommended. Anticoagulation therapy in children with thrombotic event appears to be effective. Heparin, low molecular weight heparin, and warfarin are therapeutic options. Glucocorticoids may increase the body mass index in children who are overweight when steroid therapy is initiated, and these children are more likely to remain overweight. Steroid sparing strategies may improve linear growth in children who require prolonged course of steroids. How to manage relapse of nephrotic syndrome? Relapses are common, especially in younger children, and are often triggered by upper respiratory or GI tract infections. Relapses are usually treated similar to the initial episode, except that daily prednisolone courses are shortened. That means daily high dose prednisolone is given until the child has achieved remission, and the regimen is then switched to alternative day therapy. Steroid resistant nephrotic syndrome, that is no response to steroids within first 4 weeks of therapy, and specifically FSGS is associated with a 50% risk for end stage renal disease within 5 years of diagnosis if patient do not achieve a partial or complete remission. Persistent nephrotic syndrome is associated with a poor patient reported quality of life, hypertension, serious infections, and thromboembolic events. Children reaching end stage kidney disease have a greatly reduced life expectancy. Steroid dependency, frequent relapses, and steroid resistance are candidates for alternative therapies, particularly if they have severe corticosteroid toxicity such as hypertension, cataract, Cushing's rod appearance, and growth failure. Cyclophosphamide is the most commonly used drug alternative to corticosteroids, which helps in prolonging the duration of remission and reduces the number of relapses in children with frequently relapsing and steroid-dependent nephrotic syndromes. Cyclophosphamide with a dose of 2 mg per kg is given as a single dose for a total duration of 8 to 12 weeks. Alternate day prednisolone therapy is often continued during cyclophosphamide administration. During cyclophosphamide therapy, the white blood cell count must be monitored weekly, and the drug should be withheld if the count falls below 5000 per millimeter cube. Potential side effects of the drug are neutropenia, disseminated varicella, hemorrhagic cystitis, alopecia, sterility, increased risk of future malignancy. And other commonly used drugs alternative to corticosteroids are calcineurin inhibitors like cyclosporin or tacrolimus, mycophenolate mofetil, levamisil, and rituximab. And these drugs are selected based on the response and adverse reactions on patients. With this flow diagram, we can easily understand the management of nephrotic syndrome from the first episode to the steroid resistance. Immunizations in children with nephrotic syndrome. Nephrotic syndrome patients are more prone for infections as a result of increased loss of immunoglobulin G and complements. To reduce the risk of serious infection in children with nephrotic syndrome, pneumococcal and influenza vaccines are given annually, and live viral vaccines are contraindicated in children receiving corticosteroid sparing agents such as cyclophosphamide and cyclosporin. Prognosis of nephrotic syndrome. Most children with steroid response in nephrotic syndrome have repeated relapses, which generally decreases in frequency as the child grows older. Although there is no proven way to predict an individual child's course, and it is very important to indicate to the family that the child with steroid-responsive nephrotic syndrome is unlikely to develop chronic kidney disease, that the disease is rarely hereditary, and the child will remain fertile. And to minimize the psychological effects on the condition and its therapy, children with idiopathic nephrotic syndrome should not be considered chronically ill, should participate in all age-appropriate childhood activities, maintain an unrestricted diet when in remission. Children with steroid-resistant nephrotic syndrome, most often caused by focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, generally have a poor prognosis. These children develop progressive renal insufficiency, ultimately leading to end-stage renal disease requiring dialysis or kidney transplantation. That ends the basics about proteinuria, types of nephrotic syndrome, and management of idiopathic nephrotic syndrome. Now coming to the congenital nephrotic syndrome. It is defined as nephrotic syndrome manifesting at birth or within the first 3 months of life. The causes of nephrotic syndrome in infants younger than 1 year of age is classified into primary and secondary. Primary causes are congenital nephrotic syndrome, diffuse mesangial sclerosis, minimal change disease, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis, membranous nephropathy. And secondary causes include infections, drug reactions, and syndromes associated with renal disease, such as Neil Patella syndrome, Lowy syndrome, Dennis Das syndrome, etc. Primary congenital nephrotic syndrome is due to a variety of syndrome inherited as autosomal recessive disorders. A number of structural and function abnormalities of the glomerular filtration barrier causing congenital nephrotic syndrome have been elucidated. 85% of the diseases are due to mutations in four genes and are NPHS1, NPHS2, WT1 and LAMP2. The first three of which encode components of the glomerular filtration barrier. The Finnish type of congenital nephrotic syndrome is caused by mutation in the NPHS1 or NPHS2 gene, which encodes nephrin and podocin, critical components of the slit diaphragm. The affected infants most commonly present at birth with edema caused by massive proteinuria, and they are typically delivered with an enlarged placenta. Severe hypoalbuminemia, hyperlipidemia, and hypogammaglobulinemia result from loss of filtering selectivity at the glomerular filtration barrier. The congenital nephrotic syndromes are treated with albumin and diuretic infusion, providing high amount of protein, that is 3 to 4 gram per kg, lipids, high caloric intake to maintain nutrition, along with vitamin and thyroid hormone replacement. The treatment profile also consists of unilateral nephrectomy and use of angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors and endomethacin to decrease the proteinuria and glomerular filtration rate. Commonly asked questions in theory and clinical exams are clinical manifestations of nephrotic syndrome, histological types of idiopathic nephrotic syndrome, laboratory evaluation of nephrotic syndrome, management of nephrotic syndrome, management of steroid resistant nephrotic syndrome, and congenital nephrotic syndrome. Thanks to all.